Look และกว้าง Look และกว้างความรักของพระเยซู Look และกว้าง Look และกว้าง Look และกว้างความรักของพระเยซู Look และกว้าง What am I singing? Deep and wide. That's right. So that is deep and wide in Thai. Okay, and so the interesting thing about this is that you probably think you know what you're singing. You think you're singing deep and wide, let's see. The fountains are flowing deep and wide, but that doesn't really translate too well for the Thai people. And so they changed the words to the inside of that song, and it's the love of God is deep and wide. So it's deep and wide. Deep and wide, the love of God is deep and wide. And I loved that translation because it demonstrates that they have a good idea, those who have come to faith in Christ, that the love of God is very deep and very wide. And he demonstrated that to us when, what's coming up, what holiday is coming up? What's after Thanksgiving? I thought you guys might say Christmas first. I think about Christmas before Thanksgiving, just like the rest of the world. But so at Christmas is the time that God, everything changes for us. Everything changed for mankind at Christmas. Light came into darkness. And if you come to faith in Christ, if you accept him, you will understand and have a knowledge of God that we, at that point before that, before Christ came, we weren't able to do that. But now you can because of Christmas and because of the birth of Christ, right? Yeah, yeah. Thanks for that affirmation there, little man. So what I'm in Thailand, you guys like to have Christmas parties, right? Okay, well, Thailand loves a good Christmas party too. And in Thailand, their Christmas parties are quite different from your Christmas parties. First, it's always hot, so everything's outside. Everything's always outside, and there's about 300 or 400 people that come. Some people may have more, but we always would have around from 200 to 400 people at a Christmas party. And Christmas is one of the most beautiful and easiest times of the year to share about Christ because everybody wants to come and try to get a present, and everyone gets a present. No one leaves the party. It doesn't matter how old you are. Everyone will get a present at this party. And I just want you guys to think for a minute. What do you think might be the coveted present, the one that everyone's longing for? It's there. They can see it. They don't even wrap it. And they want it so bad. What do you think it might be? Money? Nice. Everybody likes a gift card?
Toys.
Oh, that's a good one. Everybody likes toys.
The love of
the Lord. Well, that would be a good gift, right? And that's the gift that we're trying to share, but the coveted gift, the one that everyone's excited for. Okay, one more.
Toys.
Lots of toys. But the coveted present that everyone is waiting to hear who gets is a fan. A floor fan. And boy, when they win that prize, it is cheers abound. And they run up the aisle and there everybody's just so happy that they got the fan. It's very hot in Thailand. Did I mention that it's very hot all the time, all year round? I would be happy to get the fan. But you're right. The thing that the best part about it is everything that we do prior to those gifts is sharing. Sharing the Christmas story all the way to the redemption story of Christ. And so if you know anything about offerings, you might hear over the next month or so about a Lottie Moon. And so Lottie Moon did this same thing years and years and years and years ago in China. She took the love of Christ to China. And when you give to this offering during the Christmas season, those Christmas parties that all around the world, in any country you can think of, can you just think of a random country? Europe. Can you give me a country in Europe? Arkansas? Africa. We got our continents. Africa, Europe. You're right, though. All over Africa. All over. Every almost every country in the world, we have a missionary serving, and they will use this year's Christmas as an opportunity to share. And so I want us to just right now just close our eyes and just pray for these missionaries who will be using this time, and the offering that you give during Lottie Moon, it stretches all throughout the whole next year, and all of the things that these missionaries will do in order to just be there, in order to do ministry there. And, you know, I just can't say enough about how we all partner together in this mission. So let's pray for our missionaries this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Southern Baptist Churches, the goals that they have through the International Mission Board to reach the unreachable, Father, to be in places where it's very hard to share the gospel, to be in places where, you know, the idea of even Christmas time is not even understood. And so, God, we just pray right now, and I'm thinking of specific people and places that are dear to my heart, and I know the gospel will be going forth. And I just pray, God, that you will open hearts, that you will work in the lives of the people before they even hear the message, God, that they would respond, that they would say, yes, this is hopeful. Christ's story is a story of hope for my sin. And I pray, God, that this year, many people will come to faith in Christ during the holiday season and during the time, God, where we celebrate your precious gift of Christ to the world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let me let our younger kids be dismissed to children's church. Y'all can go ahead and go with them. And let me just share with you, this year we set our Lottie Moon Christmas offering goal at $6,500. It's more than we've ever done before. I want to encourage you even now, be praying about what the Lord would have you do. And let's just pray God can help us do more than that, so that just what Tracy was sharing about will be a reality. More and more people will have an opportunity to hear and know of the love of Christ. Brother Johnny?
I'm not afraid. Let's all stand, please. And let's continue to praise the Lord for that amazing grace. We bring the sacrifice of praise.
Thank you.
God's children said, amen. We ask you to join us now in this special time of prayer.
Well, good morning. Well, this is Thanksgiving week coming up, right? So I'm pretty thankful. I don't know about you guys, but I'm just very thankful to be here this morning. To us, this is just so appropriate, you know, to be here and to see so many people that we love and care about. So that's just already a blessing. Thank you for these men. What a wonderful thing, you know, to have men praying for you and before you speak. And that's my desire, is that God would use this message. Over the past year, we've been here a year now. So we've been adjusting to life in the States and what that's like. And it's different, you know. When we went to Thailand, everything was new. That's what I new foods. We're real excited, you know, new foods and the birds are different, the trees are different, everything is different. Of course, the temperature is different, too. You step off the plane at midnight and it's 90 degrees and you're thinking, oh, my goodness, you know. But it was December, right, or November, late November, so we were going from cold to hot. So you appreciate that, too, you know. You're like, well, at least, you know, we could wear shorts, right? So we're just so excited. And then things change as the years go by, and you still love it, but you start to ask different questions. Why can't they speak English? And why can't they put the menus in English? And why, you know, just all kinds of things, you know. And then come the serious questions. You start asking yourself, and that is, why haven't they heard about Jesus before? Hasn't anybody come? And then when you tell them about Jesus, why aren't more people believing? You know, and so it really sinks to the heart, because you really have to evaluate, what is the gospel? How can we share this in a way that's effective and to help these people? Because you really do see the darkness, you know. But coming back to the States, you know, there's a lot of darkness here as well. There's a lot of people here that don't know Jesus. And they may think they know what Christianity is, but most of the time, my guess is they've never really and truly heard the gospel. One of the passages of scriptures, that's what I'm going to have to look at this morning, is in Revelation, last book in your Bible, Revelation chapter 7. This passage of scripture, to me, really brings things into focus. Because it gives the big picture. One thing we need to recognize about the Bible is this whole book, you know, this whole book is one big story. It's one big story from beginning to end. And yes, it was written by 40 plus people over 1,500 years, I believe, something like that. But God put it together and wove it together in such a way, when we start reading it from cover to cover, what you find is it's God revealing himself to man and his plan and his purpose to man. And I love this chapter, Revelation chapter 7, because in this chapter what we find, and I want you to see this, what we're going to see is, what is the purpose of God? What is he doing? And why are we here? Everybody's looking for the meaning of life. It's all here. Revelation chapter 7, I'm going to read starting in verse 9 and through verse 12. It says, after this I looked, and behold, I should say first of all, this is the vision that John, the disciple of Jesus, had. And this would have been like 40 years or so after Jesus died on the cross, when he was exiled to the island of Patmos, and he's writing this as the Spirit is revealing this to him, and he's writing down this book. And here he has this vision that he sees, and he's writing down what he sees, okay? So verse 9, after this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Have you ever been reading a book and you're just like, is this guy going to make it? Is the main character going to die? You know, and so you skip ahead a few pages, and oh, there, his name is still in there, so we're good, you know. Or you might want to look at the very end if it's very, you know, what happens at the end? I don't know if I can keep reading this. All right, look, when we don't know what to do in life, it is so helpful sometimes. Go to the end of the book, you know. Revelation, yeah, it's sure, there's a lot of figurative stuff in there, but there's a lot of really clear things in there as well. And this is one of them. And what do you see in this passage? One thing you see is God is on his throne. You see God the Father on his throne. He is sovereign over all. Secondly, you see his King, the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God, of course, that's talking about Christ Jesus. And then you see his kingdom. I'm sorry, his people. You see his people, a multitude that no one can number. All right? You see his salvation. I'm going to go back through these. I'm just giving you an overview real quick here. His salvation, what he is doing in this world, his mission to reconcile us to himself, and then his purpose to bring glory to the Lamb. All right, so I want us to go back now. Look, so the first thing is first thing we see is God is on his throne, and then we see, and he is sovereign over all things. God is sovereign over all things. And then we see that his king, he has established his king, and it is the Lamb of God, talking about Christ Jesus. It's a picture of a king and his kingdom. The Jewish people understood when they said, they used the word Messiah. The word Messiah comes from the Hebrew, and it means the anointed one. And they understood very clearly this was talking about a king. So they were expecting the Messiah. If you remember in the Christmas story, the wise men come to Jerusalem, and they ask them, where is he who is born king of the Jews? And the religious leaders weren't confused by that. They knew that the word Messiah is talking about the king. It's anointed the king, the one that the anointed king, because they would pour oil over the head of the one who was to be anointed king. And they knew this is talking about the Messiah. Well, he's to be born in Bethlehem. That's how they understood it. When Jesus was, even when he was proclaimed himself, you know, as the, even when he said that he was the Son of Man, they understood that was a word, a name for the Messiah. And they said, and when he called God his Father, they said, hey, you, when you say God your Father, you're making yourself equal with God. You see, and so they understood that this Messiah was much more, it was much more than what the Jewish people understood it to be. He was king, but he was much more than that. He's God with us. And when we see the reference of the Lamb on the throne, the Lamb, Jesus is the Lamb, in Revelation chapter 5, verse 12. You don't have to turn here. I'm going to read a few verses that you don't have to turn to, and I'll tell you when to turn to the next one, okay? You can look if you want to. I'm just saying that just to keep everybody from losing me here. But Revelation 5, 12, it says, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. It's talking about Jesus, the Lamb who was slain. In John 1, verse 9, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is how John the Baptist introduces Jesus to the people. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And in another place of Revelation said that he was the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. It's God's plan from the beginning. And so they're not seeing a sheep before the throne. You understand who it is Christ Jesus before the throne of God. And he is the King, the Messiah. Another word for Messiah in the Greek is Christ. It's not Jesus Christ as in his surname. It is Jesus who is the anointed King. If we're going to put that in, it is God's King put into place. And that's what we see at the end. That is God's purpose. You see what I'm saying? This is what God's doing. We also see his people. You cannot have a king and a kingdom unless there are people. What would it be like for a king to be by himself and he's over his country but there are no people? No. He is calling a people to himself. And that is the message of the gospel. The message of the gospel is the king, the rightful king has come. And it is King Jesus. And he has come to reign. And the invitation goes out for all who will hear. Will you accept him as your king? Because he is calling people from every nation, every tribe, every ethnic group, every language. Everyone gets the invitation. Come and join the kingdom of God. You don't just join it by joining a church. You do it by accepting Christ as your king. You give your allegiance to him. You see that? That's what God is doing. That's what Christ is doing under God's sovereignty, is Christ is calling a people to himself from every tribe, tongue, and nation. And notice it says it's a multitude that no one could number. That gives me hope. You know, when I'm in Thailand and I see so many lost people, I just believe it's not going to remain this way. I think of South Korea, just 50 years ago, was a Buddhist nation. But it is now predominantly a Christian nation. God can do amazing things. In Indonesia, one thing about being a missionary, especially with the Southern Baptists, is you're connected with missionaries, all at least for us, all throughout Southeast Asia. So we hear, oh, God's doing an amazing thing in Indonesia. You know, in Sumatra, 1,000 people out of this group came to Christ where there was nobody, you know, in 1 year. You know, those kind of things happen. And God is doing things. They can be rare, but God does work. And you see the door opens and people start coming into the kingdom. And it's an amazing thing. And that's what we want to happen. We want it to happen here in the U.S. and we want it to happen around the world, among these different people groups. We want His people to come in. The third thing we see is it's His salvation. It says in verse 10, "And crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God." Salvation belongs to our God. This is His salvation. He is offering to save you and to redeem you and to cleanse you of your sins and to bring you to Himself. That's God's mission. That's what God's doing. I want you to turn now to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. And I want us to look at Christ's mission. What was Christ, what was Jesus doing when He was on this earth? What was He telling the people? Look at Luke chapter 4. And we're going to start in verse 16 and read down to verse 21. Look what happens. Verse 16. He, meaning Jesus, went to Nazareth, where He had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, He went into the synagogue, as was His custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to Him. Unrolling it, He found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on Me, because He has anointed Me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent Me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then He rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on Him. He began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." This scripture, Isaiah, this was written like 600 years before Christ. 600 years before Christ, the Holy Spirit instructed Isaiah to, he wrote down these things. "The Spirit of the Lord is on Me to, because He has anointed Me." There's that anointed, remember, is talking about the anointing of the Messiah, the King, to proclaim good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the oppressed free. And so you got to realize what this is saying is that, understand, it says freedom for the prisoners. The prisoners of what? Well, the prisoners of sin, for one thing. And that's all of us. He has come to proclaim freedom. Do you know, in Romans it says that we were enslaved to sin. Before we know Christ, before we belong to Him, we are enslaved to sin, which means with our sin nature in us, we have no choice. We might try to do good, but we're always going to fall back into sin because we are just tied to sin. We are chained to sin. But when Christ comes and when we come to Him, He breaks that chain and we are set free from sin. We are set free. We're the prisoners are set free. That's what it's talking about. And then it says He comes to give sight to the spiritually, to the blind. Yes, He did give sight physically to the blind. But remember, when He talks to the Pharisees, he tells them they're blind. And how are they blind? They're spiritually blind. Christ has come to give sight to us and to open our spiritual eyes so that we can understand. You see, He comes, another place in Romans it says that we're dead because of trespasses and sin. It's talking about our spirit. Our spirit's the way we communicate with God. It's dead because of trespasses and sin. When we are apart from Christ, we have no communication with God because our spirit is dead. We can't hear Him. But what He does in Christ, when we come to Christ, and when He comes in us, He opens us, He opens up our hearts, and He awakens us. And He makes the Spirit in us alive so that we can understand spiritual things. And all of a sudden, the Bible, this book, becomes alive to us. Because we're like, I get this. This makes sense. In fact, Everything makes sense now because he's opened my eyes. He's taken a blind man and he's helped me to see. That's what salvation is. And then the third thing is, says he's come to set the oppressed free. He's come to set the oppressed free. And yes, Jesus did cast out demons out of people. And let me tell you, there is real demonic powers in this world today. I mean, that's not like necessarily what you picture in the movies. It's talking about the fallen angel, Satan, as we would call him, and his minions, I'll say. But I like to use that word. But that are at work trying to deceive us, right, and keep us under his yoke. And it tells us that we are all under the dominion of the evil one until we come to Christ, the rightful king. Because when you give your life to Christ, you are giving your allegiance to him as king. And you're saying, I no longer want to be under the dominion of the evil one. I want to be under the rightful king, Christ Jesus, the Lamb of God. And I accept him for my king. And when you do that, Satan has no more authority over you. You are under a different king. We were oppressed, but now we have been set free. That is the good news of the gospel. That is what we all desire. So yes, and yes, it's more than that. It includes eternal life with God forevermore, right? But in this life, there is hope. In this life, God wants to awaken you. Jesus said, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly, or have life to the full. God made you to know him and be in relationship with him. And he wants to give you this life, this salvation. And we need to come to him and humble ourselves, repent of our sins, and give our lives to him, and accept Christ Jesus as our King. That's when the transformation begins. Now, all this to bring about his mission. I want you to look at one more place, Matthew chapter 4. So turn back a few more books to Matthew. Matthew chapter 4. I want you to see the mission of Jesus on this earth and what he's doing with his disciples. All right? Because when we belong to Christ, we become his disciples. And it's important that we understand what is our role in this. Now, I want you to look at this, Matthew chapter 4, starting in verse 17 through 20. What I want you to see here is that from first to last, from beginning to end, Jesus is passing on his mission to his disciples. Now, look at starting in verse 17. It says, from that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. While walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, now listen to this, and I will make you fishers of men. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. Now I want you to see is Jesus didn't hide anything from them. Right from the beginning, he's saying, you follow me, and I have a purpose for you, and that is that you will be fishers of men. Now what's he saying? He's saying right from the beginning, he's saying, when you come to me, I have a purpose for you. And that is to help other people come back into a right relationship with God. That's our purpose in Christ. If you and I belong to Christ Jesus, we have a purpose in this life. And it is to help others. Not to help ourselves now. It is to help other people also come into relationship with God, a right relationship with God. In the middle of his ministry, we see in Luke chapter 10, Jesus is even training his disciples. He sends them out in twos. Pairs them up and sends them out in the villages. He says, go out into these villages and proclaim the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then at the very end, what's the last thing Jesus says to his disciples? Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. He tells his disciples, go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Do you see? From first beginning, middle, and end, Jesus is saying, if you follow me, I have a purpose. It's that you will be fishers of men. It's that you will help people back into a right relationship with God. And now I'm sending you and I'm commanding you that we go to the people wherever you are. You know, so yes, some people God sends to the far nations of the world. Some people sends God sends permanently. Some people God sends temporarily, whatever. But sometimes God says, go to your neighbors. Go to the people around you, the communities, the next town over. Go and tell people come into a right relationship with God. We have a mission. God wants to use us as well. Now, and it's, I love 2 Corinthians 5. If you want to look at that one, you can do that. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 18 and 19, just two verses here. I love these verses because they really sum this up. 2 Corinthians 5, 18 and 19, it says, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That big word, reconciliation, means to help people get right with God. Right? He gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. It's all so clear. It's all so clear. It all just comes together. It's his salvation. It's his salvation. It's God's plan. It's God's salvation. It's what he is doing. And it's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing to consider. And all that comes back to his purpose and to his glory. Back in Revelation chapter 7, I'm going to read those last 11 verses, 11, 12 again. It says, and all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. You know, when you get this, when you understand what God has done for you, we cannot help but give glory and honor to him. Wisdom, blessing, and glory, and honor, and wisdom, and thanksgiving. I didn't plan that because of thanksgiving. I'm saying that verse just happens to be in there, or that word just happens to be in there. But our ultimate aim is that all will be for the glory of God. When we gather together weekly, or bi-weekly, however often we gather to worship him, we come to give glory to him as the body of Christ. We worship him. We give thanks to him. We praise him in song. We treasure and study his word and listen to his word, all because of what he has done, and so that we can surrender our lives afresh for his purpose. That's our desire. That's what we want to do. So, let me conclude this with some questions, all right? First of all, we each need to ask ourselves, who am I? Where am I? Where am I? Have I put my trust in Christ Jesus? Have I understood this message? Has I understood the gospel before? And have I committed my life? Have I accepted Jesus as my king? Is Jesus my king? Because if we have not done that, the first thing we need to do is come to him. and repent and turn from our sins and commit our lives to Him and say, yes, Jesus, I want to have all of You and I want to give all of me to You. You know, I picture it like a marriage, you know, and the Bible does too, I guess, right? So, but it is, you know, the husband gives all of himself to the wife and the wife gives all of herself to the husband, right? And that's what happens in a ceremony. And that's what God wants to happen with us. If we want to give Him all that we are and we want to accept from Him all that He has to give for us. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. And so I just want to encourage you, do that. I implore you. God, Christ has come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Now I want to have another question, and this is for those of us who do belong to Christ. We do belong to Christ. The second question is this: what is His purpose for me? What is His purpose for me? And it's twofold in a way. One is to give worship and glory and honor and thanksgiving to Him. We should be doing that. We should be giving glory to Him and live our lives in such a way that we can do that. But the second part of that is so important, that we accept His mission and that we are helping other people be reconciled to God, bringing people, inviting people to a right relationship with the living God. That's what we're to be doing. And I want to encourage you to make that your mission. And then the third question is, how am I to do this? How do we do that? How do we go about doing that? And for me, there's three words that come to mind that have been real helpful to me, especially over the last year, as I've been being here in the States and kind of adjusting to a new place and a new thing. God just brought these things to my mind. One is the word promptings. I'm going to explain that. Passions and purposes. And that is this: the promptings of the Spirit. You know, when we belong to Christ, the Holy Spirit lives in us and He prompts us. You know, in other words, He says, hey, how about that guy over there? You know, and we need to listen. You know, so often I struggle with, I feel like, gosh, I don't think I was really listening when God was talking to me, you know. And we want to listen to His prompting so that we'll be ready to share with people, you know, and go talk to them. And we need to be awake to the things that God is doing around us and keep this mission before us so that we can do that. You know, so listening to the promptings of His Spirit. And the passions is the second word, is that passions for the things of God. The passion for the things of God. We need to be motivated by His passion. By His passion in us. As we love Him, as we rejoice in what He has done for us, that needs to motivate us to be sharing this with the people that we meet. And finding those ways. Looking for keys to do that, you know. And by that I mean this, you know, we need to be praying. God, open my eyes to see the people around me. God, give me opportunities to share Your love with the people that I'm seeing. Help me to do it. Give me the boldness to open my mouth and ask the right questions and help them to see their need for a Savior. And so all this, we need to be intentional in those conversations and keep His purposes. And then the third one is purposes. We need to keep His purposes before us. And that takes us right back to that last verse there in Revelation 7. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. That's the purpose. That's what we need to keep before us. Keep the purpose before us. Let His passions motivate us to do His will and listen for the promptings of the Spirit so that we can be His instruments, that people will be reconciled to God wherever we are. Amen? Amen. God bless y'all.
Tell you what, I think it's important to understand that even today, you're not here by accident. I know some of you are visiting with us. Some of you have been here regularly. But you know what? We serve a God who is always at work in this world. He is always working, drawing us to Himself. I'm so grateful that God has raised up Keith and Tracy, even through the time they were a part of this church, and sent them out to carry that message, the message of the kingdom of God, the message of Jesus Christ who went to the cross and died, that all who would trust in Him might have life in His name. And you know what? It's just a matter of doing just what He just talked about, us being willing to respond to that prompting of His Spirit. Maybe you're here and you've never trusted Christ. Certainly today, we would ask you, would you hear that prompting? Maybe today you need to trust Christ. Most of us here would say, well, Brother Mike, I know Christ. Understand, you know, we look at Keith and Tracy, we think they're the missionaries. But can I just tell you, in the scripture he just told and read through, do you know who the missionaries are? It's you, if you know Jesus. And I pray you would be found faithful. You would be found faithful in living for His glory and honor. You would be found faithful sharing that gospel. Let's stand together. Brother Johnny is going to come and lead us in our hymn of invitation. And my invitation to you is very simple today. It's that you would respond to the prompting of His Spirit. Maybe He would prompt you to come to the altar and get some things right with God. Maybe He's prompting you to come and pray. Maybe today He's prompting you to trust Christ or to renew your commitment to Him. Whatever God would have you do, as we would begin to sing, we invite you to come. I'm going to invite Keith to be here at the front. I'm going to invite Jeff to be here at the front with me. As God speaks to your heart, you come.
Just as I am without one plea, but that Thy blood was shed for me.